producing electricity, and I put it inside another one, a little larger, and that one's running, what happens? Hey, what do you know? Gravity disappears.
Right.
And he said, well, that's kind of interesting. Now, what would the vehicle that would use this as a propulsion, this form of propulsion, what would it, how would it move? What kind of things would it do? And he started studying that. He said, well, wait a second. We've got them. I mean, they're on the Earth, and it's what we call UFOs.
Mm-hmm.
And he had never believed in UFOs, studied UFOs for 5 years, cataloged them, and said, folks, it's all here. They are using that, and everybody who's ever been brought up, the abductees who come back and describe the interiors of these vehicles, all describe the same thing, and they are describing an oscillatory chamber. So it's here. We can make believe it's not, and governments can say it's not, but I think by this time we're all pretty sure that it is.
Yeah, I have this idea, and I used to think everything began at Roswell. And I'm thinking that it went far before then, and Roswell was just a part of the discoveries that may have happened in Europe in the 1930s.
I think Roswell is simply the beginning of the information getting out. I mean, the stuff has been here for a hell of a long time.
Yeah, I would agree with you, because, I mean, after doing a lot of historical studies about Europe, and you're bringing up the Polish thing, the Polish inventor, there was Schornberger, who did the vortex technology.
Right.
And then there's also, I don't know if you've heard of the Nazi Bell technology that was...
Heard about it. I don't know much about it, though.
It was very dangerous technology that they allegedly were working on. Something crashed, allegedly, out there near Czechoslovakia. And the Luftwaffe and the SS and all the scientists, they grabbed it, took it into the Owl Mountains, and they were working on some project, and they said they had this antimatter that they were using, and it was unstable, and they put it in these saucer craft, and that's where you get the, what do you call them, the Foo Fighters. You had those Foo Fighters, which were those balls of light that would follow the Allied planes as they were doing bombing runs over Europe.
Right.
And so, you know, you don't know where that technology came. They did, and the Allied powers had no idea what this was, and the Axis... powers thought that it was the Allied powers, but it wasn't. None of them knew where it was coming from, and the secret was is they were developing these saucer-like craft in Germany because Hitler wanted these wonder weapons. He called Wunder weapons. They wanted these Wunder weapons to be made, and they were like these big tanks and these huge things, you know, like very much like the technology you see in Robotech, you know, the big ship and that sort of thing, the big tanks and the firing weapons that you see firing on those on the aircraft and on the robots. So, yeah, I mean, it just seemed to me that when I was watching Robotech that a lot of that technology reminded me of the old German technology and the proposals.
I don't have any doubts that it's been around for quite some time. I really don't. All I can say is thank God for Internet at this point.
Yeah.
The information is gotten out now, is getting and continues to get out so quickly that it can't be stopped. And no matter how much they cover it or say, no, it's not true, and all the usual stories, there are too many people now that know that that's just not the case.
Yeah, there's too many people out there that know it, and you know, and we already know it deep down inside, and we've heard the stories, and we've seen, and we've read the mythologies, and we have to try and piece it all together and try to figure out, you know, just what is the truth. But I think deep down we know that we're not alone.
Sure we do. Well, it's numerically, statistically impossible.
Exactly. Greg Snagov's my guest tonight on Ground Zero. So glad to have him on the program talking about Robotech. In fact, Robotech, if you watch Robotech, you will see how it will spawn all kinds of imagination about alien worlds, a 30-year alien war, clones, knowing a little bit about the origins of man in the mythologies with the Invid and several other alien groups, the hive mind, all those things are there. Very fascinating show, Robotech. We'll talk more with Greg about it. If you have any questions, 503-417-9595 or 1-877-733-1011. We'll be back with more. Keep it here on Ground Zero.
XM News 101 KXL.
Hello. You are about to experience Ground Zero, an off-speaker experience. Cuts through the crowd. Just when you thought you were safe.
Clyde Lewis, and this is Ground Zero. You know, there were two shows I remember that I didn't like missing when I was a kid. And then as I got older, I liked watching anime as well. But one of them was G-Force, that Battle of the Planets. I used to watch that religiously. I loved that show. And then I found a show to replace it. And that was Robotech. And I watched it for a while, and I didn't like missing a show because it was a lot of fun. It reminded me of G-Force. It reminded me of Battle of the Planets. I love those anime shows, the manga shows. And, of course, I graduated up into things like, you know, Vampire Hunter, and I graduated up and watched other shows like, you know, Akira and, you know, several of those movies. And also Ghost in the Shell. That was one of the best shows that I had watched. But you can't let go of some of the great stuff that you remember with Robotech. And tonight, Greg Snegoff is with us, and he was the voice of Kyron and Scott. And we were just really excited. We're just really excited to have him on the program tonight. We're talking about anything. We're talking about Robotech, but we're also talking about the spirit behind Robotech. And how all of the mythologies wrapped into Robotech, the 30-year alien war, the technology left behind by the aliens and using it for power and the marvels of the Robotech world and all that, how it impressed me when I was younger actually, and how it impressed today, and how some of the stories in Robotech somehow are similar to the stories we hear about the aliens and the ancient aliens and the idea of technologies with us. And so we were kind of dabbling in that a little bit with Greg, talking about fourth dimension technology, talking about, talking about anti-gravity technology, which is also interesting. And so if you want to call in tonight, the numbers to call 503-417-9595. That's 9KXL or 1-877-733-1011. You know, we were talking about 4D technology a little bit, Greg. What do you think about 4D technology, really? I mean, is it there? Are we going to make that quantum jump with this technology?
That's exactly what it's about. That's the perfect word for it. It is a quantum jump. It's you'll be talking to Fiorella Capuano later in the show, and that's what it's all about. 4D technology has nothing to do with building a better bomb. It has to do with getting away from three-dimensional technology, machinery of any form, and getting back and utilizing the naturally occurring powers of any human being. If you're born a human, you've got them. You've got these abilities. And there's a number of folks who are doing their level best to make you forget that you have them. Not everybody has, obviously, thank goodness. But 4D technology has to do with time. It's very, very, very simple. And she'll be telling you about some of the discoveries made by Professor Jose Arguelles, who is the man who is personally responsible for all of the attention in these last 20 years being paid to what's happening around the end of this year, in December of 2012. This big, big, big mind shift.
I read Arguez's book, and it convinced me that that's what's going to happen. Is there a huge time shift? And we're feeling it now. I think a lot of it is the dimensional. I mean, look at the TV shows we have right now, too. You look at Fringe. They did have one called Flash Forward. And the idea that there is another universe or a doppelganger universe or what they call a shadow genesis. That at the same time as we were being created here on this planet, there was something that was just right next to us being created at the same time. And that may be the alien universe. That may be, I mean, you know, people are always thinking they're traveling from planet to planet. And maybe there are people traveling planet to planet. But the whole idea of these beings, whatever they may be, and you said that they were different ones, you felt. I mean, even though Robotech tells us that we have several different alien types, do you think that there are different alien types out there? You said there were some that may be nice, some that may not be so nice. What do you think of that idea?
Sure. Even if we've never seen them, even if we've never had contact with them, statistically, it's just impossible that, A, we're alone, and, B, since we're obviously not alone, that there can only be one type in the entire universe. I mean, let's keep in mind how many galaxies there are in here, how many planets, how many stars, gazillions. It is impossible that there's only one kind, kind of anything.
Well, see, and that's another thing I liked about Robotech is you look at the Invid and how they were like a crab-like creature or a crab-like alien.
Yeah, and sort of slug-like.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, and I did a lecture about this once. I talked about how we're so quick to believe aliens to look like us, or at least with two eyes, a mouth, and a nose, that if an alien showed up, they'd just look like a slug, or like they did, other movies that I've seen where they're like arachnids, or they're crabs, or they're, you know, or something like that. We would be frightened by that, and even if they were trying to be nice to us, we would be frightened because of their hideous look. That's what I'm worried about.
Probably.
Yeah. I mean, if something showed up looking like a lobster, we'd want to put butter on him and boil him. I mean, that's how we think, you know?
we have to... there's that show years ago, Alien Nation.
Yes.
Remember?
Mm-hmm, I remember.
That put forth some interesting ideas, sort of reverse racism. We think anybody who's coming down, we're probably going to shoot them and then ask questions. But what about the opposite? What if they come down and say, God, these creatures are the most repulsive things I've ever seen in my life. They're probably not worth anything.
Right.
That's possible.
Well, they look at us as like ants or cows, you know, and they're saying, oh, you know. But it's true. I mean, what if there was an alien race that came to us and said, we need your help? See, we're all waiting for them to come and save us. What if they came here and said, we really need your help, we're dying, we've been on this ship, we've been adrift in space for so long, and now we finally find a place where we can settle.
Exactly.
Would we accept them? Would we take them in? Or we'd say, why do we want to have this race come and occupy our planet? It's just going to cause problems.
Yeah, exactly. There's have you ever heard of, there are a lot of researchers doing work with the abductees.
Yeah.
Have you heard of a man named Malanga?
No, I haven't. No.
He's one of the top ones. He has, he's actually a biochemist. He's a professor in one of the universities in Italy. And he developed a regressive hypnotic technique. And he puts people's, the basic personality of someone when they go into trance, he sort of puts it aside. And then he started asking questions, for example, who else is in there? And people started, or something, started answering. And he came across this. He's worked with thousands of cases now, people who either knew they've been abducted or thought they've been abducted or didn't know, but weird things were happening to them. And with this technique, he's able to not only discover who is in there, but to get them out. And what he's discovering is that many people have literally implanted in their brains, not an alien, not a being. We're not talking about a bug living inside their heads. We're talking